Hello, friends. Thank you for all of your messages and your emails of support and your comments. And thank you for keeping the conversation alive and for taking a stand with me. Now, thanks to YouTube's 10-minute policy, I have very little time to discuss a massive topic, so I'm going to get on and create the context for this week's broadcast. When I'm having discussions with people about the New World Order, I've noticed the general trend seems to be discussing the consequences or the end game. In other words, people are talking about martial law and RFID chips and compulsory chipping and cashless societies. And that's all dreadful stuff. But that's in the future. That is a consequence of not taking actions that we could take right now. We could be there for sure, no doubt about it, if we do not do certain things that we can do right now. And so what I feel needs to happen is we need to step back. We're all staring at the end game. We're all looking at the consequences, and we're not looking at what we can be doing right now. We're all focused on the future, and we're failing to act in the present. And so what we need to talk about right now is the European Union and the American Union, the North American Union. So I'm going to deal with the European Union first. And rather than go into the history of it all, there are many, many videos out there that can tell you all about the history of the European Union. Far better than I can. I, of course, will use certain clips to illustrate my point. But essentially, I want to talk really about what it involves, the future of it, the present of it. So let's look at a brief outline first.
The plan is to create a federal European superstate. Into it will be merged up to 25 ancient European nations, including our own. This new country, called Europe, will have one parliament, one government, one court of justice, one currency, one flag.
Now, I'm a very spiritual person. I believe that we're all one. In the words of Bill Hicks, we're all one consciousness experiencing itself subjectively. And so what is wrong with this oneness that they're trying to create? What's wrong with being one global nation, or one European nation under one flag, with one national anthem, one police force, one government? What is wrong with that? We're all one, right? What is the cost of us all becoming one as they would have it?
In black and white, the draft constitution wording confirms Brussels will exercise competence and primacy over member states' own laws. For the British, this will mean being stripped of any remaining independence, the scrapping of the pound sterling to be replaced by the euro, the handing over of our remaining currency and gold reserves to the European Central Bank, and the total regulation of British domestic and international trade by the European Union.
Well, you only have to look at what happened to our fisheries when we handed those over to Europe all those years ago to see the dire consequences that those trade agreements and the trade regulations would have on our country. I think the biggest problem with using the euro in this whole argument with the British people is that I think we're all very complacent about it. And because traveling around Europe and getting to and from Europe from England is very easy and cheap, I would say the majority of people in this country have used the euro at some point over the last few years. They know what it feels like, they know what it looks like, they've used it in everyday transactions. And so I believe that because it's already part of our vocabulary and part of the way we live our lives, it's not seen for the threat that it actually is to our economy. Now, the other aspect of legislation from Brussels is that our legal system would be in jeopardy. Now, you would think, wouldn't you, that because our legal system in the UK is held up in high regard and is probably one of the best, most fair systems around the whole world, they would use that as a benchmark to create some sort of fair and just legal system within the country of Europe.
The new European justice system currently being introduced into the UK is known as corpus juris, literally body of law. Corpus juris is designed completely and permanently to overhaul the British justice system and will include the following. The scrapping of trial by jury. Henceforth, you will face a state-appointed judge who will pronounce you guilty or not guilty. The scrapping of habeas corpus. You are liable to summary arrest without charge.
Under Corpus Juris, you can be detained without charge or any evidence being presented against you for up to 9 months. The scrapping of innocent until proven guilty. Henceforth, a citizen must prove his innocence against the combined machinery of the state. The scrapping of double jeopardy, or not being tried for the same offence twice. Under EU sanction, Jack Straw, while Home Secretary, gave prosecutors leave to appeal not guilty verdicts if desired. Technically, this could be done repeatedly until the required conviction is secured. The scrapping of non-disclosure. Henceforth, under Corpus Juris, any previous convictions you have will be made available to the court before your trial begins. There is no presumption of innocence.
Oh, well, that's not good. Well, at least if we don't like what they're doing, we can always vote them out, right? We'll vote in some new fair people with some integrity. I think that's probably the way to go.
Laws of the European Union are drafted not by the Euro Parliament, but by the EU Commission, one of three powerful forums in which the true might of the Union resides. Members of these forums are not elected to their positions, nor, we are told, will they ever be. These unelected, inscrutable forums dictate what citizens across the Eurozone can and can't do, down to the last detail.
Well, that's not good either. But if push comes to shove, you know, we can always send our army in. We'll send our armed forces in. They will sort the whole thing out, diplomatically, of course. And we will be back to square one again. We'll have our pound back, and we will have our national sovereignty back, and once again, the armed forces will have sorted the whole thing out. Thank God we have them under our control.
Being part of the European Union will mean Britain will permanently lose control over her armed forces and foreign policy.
They can use our armed forces, the Crown Forces, the Army, the Navy and the Air Force, in the European Rapid Reaction Force. And imagine our forces being under the command of some perhaps French or German general.
Now, if you follow politics in this country and you're aware of what's going on, you'll know that the systems, all of the systems for a very effective police state are now in place. They're just not being utilised, but they are there to switch on whenever the need arises. So it's these last two aspects, the use of our armed forces and the loss of our British legal system, our system of law, that concerns me most. Every piece of legislation that comes out of Europe now will be enforced by our own armed services and by our own police against us, the British public. There's so much legislation coming out of Brussels right now that you could be breaking a law just watching this video and not know it. I think what I've seen that illustrates this point best recently is a short film called Patriotism in the UK. Do a Google search and look it up, it's well worth your time. So this brings us to the European Parliament in Brussels, and what you would think would be a potential solution, having an MEP to speak on your behalf. Now the bottom line is that it's only open for 4 days a month, and during that time there are so many pieces of legislation being passed through each day on those 4 days that your MEP only has 60 seconds to speak on any particular piece of legislation he feels he wants to contest. After 60 seconds, his mic is turned off and he has to sit down. Surely the answer then is to have the European Parliament open every day, all day, like our own Parliament here in the UK is. But the party line is that it's such an expensive enterprise gathering all of these politicians from their home countries in one spot to debate that we couldn't possibly afford it. Now, as one MEP whistleblower recently revealed, these corrupt politicians from these different countries, including our own, are buying cheap flights to Brussels and then charging the European Parliament the full fare for a first-class ticket. Now, from what I've seen and heard, this airline scam is well known within the European Parliament, and so if cost really was the issue, they would have stamped that out by now. But we all know that doesn't matter. It's not about cost at all. It's about getting this legislation through as fast as possible. It's meant to be that way. 4 days, 60 seconds per politician, reams of policy to be read the night before the votes are taken. Our own corrupt politicians now hamstrung with their hands tied behind their backs and their mouths gagged. We've been denied a referendum. The New World Order agenda is on rails and it is moving fast. How do we resist it? Civil disobedience? Are there enough of us to cause a problem for them? Please, research the European Union. If you're an American, research the North American Union. Keep talking to each other, keep asking questions, and wake up the sheeple. Thanks for listening.